So the second thing, yes.
Well, I was just thinking. I just came back from North Dakota from the
Standing Rock. Yes.
And it was extremely emotional and moving for me. And like, what I realize is, you know, like that pipeline is a very concrete material thing to rally around. And the lady over here was talking about your farm. Like, I saw those things at the camp. Like, they have eight kitchens going on in that camp. People are building, you know, winterized teepees. They have a school for their kids. They have arts and culture. They have all this stuff. It's amazing. And so I'm wondering, in this particular, with this stuff, like, you know, police brutality, all of these sort of, all of these systems that kind of operate in the shadows, even though we can see it and smell it, it's like, it's not as concrete as there's the tractor and they're digging in a pipeline, you know what I mean?
So I think it is, though. For me, police brutality is very concrete because there's people that I know that experience.
Yeah, no, of course. And that, I mean, that's the result of that. That's the result that is material. But, like, how do you, as a community, or how do you do something in a direct action kind of way towards that?
I don't think direct action towards it is what we should do. Right, I think that trying to find ways to empower. The idea of abolishing police.
Yeah.
The idea that we can police ourselves, right? To some extent, the effort to do that. That's what I favor more than trying to go back and forth with. We don't got the guns to go to war with the police. We literally don't have, you know, 13% of the population, you want to add Latinos, Indigenous, Native, and I say this tongue in cheek, but they will literally kill us all, right? So trying to directly combat that is, I think it's self-destructive. Now, are there subversive things we can do? Of course, right? The second thing I want to talk about, because we're talking about building this community, and one of the legacies of the Panthers I want to talk about is occupying academic space. What I say, and not in your curriculum, if you're bound by some curriculum, but there are spaces and things you can use. I have colleagues that decorate their classrooms, right? And the idea is that if you see someone on the wall, if the students ask about it, then that gives you the leeway to open up the conversation, right? Oftentimes, as educators, especially in public schools, you're limited to what you can provide, but if they bring the conversation to you, then what kind of educator would you be if you didn't indulge, right? So the idea of finding ways to occupy academic space, and this is one of the things that's important to me as an instructor at a place like Merritt College, right? At a community college where students come, often, you know, our motto is we change lives, and people come to try to improve the fundamental conditions of their life. So I try to make my classroom a space where students can talk, where students can feel comfortable, where students can come to me outside of the classroom if they have an issue going on. I try to make sure that my career, even though it's sociology, right, which is one of the most Eurocentric disciplines that has existed, one of the ones used to justify things like slavery and colonialism, I'm a critical race sociologist. So I teach my students to critique everything. Right, because I know that they may not get another sociology instructor like me if they go into this discipline. Right, so my job, while I have them in class, is to give them whatever tools I can give them. Our jobs as educators is to provide space on campus for students to grow. Right, yes, sir.
I didn't want to interrupt you. I wanted you to finish. I'm sorry. I
saw the hand shoot up. So.
All right, cool. Real quick, I had a question previously, but real quick. First off, it almost sounds like you're saying that protesting can be counterproductive. But my real question, you know what I mean? Cool, okay, I got that point. Okay, cool. my second point is, as far as the intellectual legacy of the Black Panthers, right? I imagine we're in a room full of academics. I consider myself more of an intellectual than an academic.
I don't consider myself an academic. I don't know if we have many academics in the room. And I say that because if you're going to speak to the academic,
I feel you. Okay, but my question is that what the Black Panthers were able to do so well way back then, I think it's a piece that's missing right now, which is they're able to relate all the academic jargon and all these philosophies of sociology to street people, the lumpen.
Yes, like the lumpen proletariat.
Right. You know what I mean? The lumpen proletariat. And that's something that we're missing, I think, right now. Because you're talking about, like, occupying all these academic spaces, and that's something that people who are affected by the school-to-prison pipeline are never going to be able to do. They're going to stay on the street.
No, I'm gonna acknowledge your point. Because I did you come in a little late?
Yes, I did.
There we go. Because the third, because the third thing, right? So I got 3 points. So the first point is doing the study, understanding your conditions, right? That's the second piece is occupying, because that's the legacy of what the Panthers did. So the Panthers were able to find a way to occupy academic space. So in continuing that legacy, as I was saying, as the conditions of black students on white college campuses become more hostile, we have to find a way to carve out space for them. We also have to put the feet to the fire of HBCUs to educate our youth in ways that they're gonna be able to use that to empower their communities, right?
I don't know what you just said, but
the third thing, right, that I haven't quite gotten to yet is how to translate all this knowledge into fundamentally changing the conditions of your community. Because that's the legacy, like you said, of the Panthers. Yeah. It wasn't that they were studying and writing academic journals. It's that they were being able to convey that information to people who were barely literate, mm-hmm. right? And that's the work, right? I love teaching at a community college. I love teaching at Merritt specifically. Right? Coming to get that extra credit. I got And I say that because it's allowed me to become an amazing educator, because I can have people in one classroom that have a master's and are coming back for a change of career in the same classroom with someone who reads at a third grade level. And I have to create a way for them all to be able to get something out of what I say and be able to dialogue and communicate with each other. And I say that, and you know how I learned? Panthers taught me how to do that, right? They taught me how to do that. But that's the work. In terms of occupying academic space, realizing that I believe I'm hard on my students.
Oh yes.
because they're brilliant, right? And I don't want them to ever question their brilliance when they go into spaces where people are going to look at them like they don't belong, right? So as educators, we have to make sure that we have to tell them, we have to show them, we have to make them understand, you're just as brilliant as me, right? They look at me, I make mistakes every day, right? You are just as brilliant as I am. The second thing is the idea, the black campus movements were what allowed me to be an instructor, what allowed Afram to be at a place like Merritt College. It was the students at those colleges that pushed for black faculty, that push for ethnic studies programs. So in the tradition of that legacy, students' involvement and leadership has to be better, right? And it comes from practitioners or people that are investing in helping students understand what it means to be a leader. If you've never ran a meeting, someone should teach you how to run a meeting. So if we want, because organization is necessary, I have so many students that have so much passion and so much promise, and they're waiting for someone to say, tell me how to do this, right? And once you show them, look over them, watch them do it, they do amazing things. But we have to, and it takes time, right? You say, why are you up at campus at 6 p.m.? Mm-hmm. Because this is the work, mm-hmm. right? This is what's necessary for my students to be what they need to be when they leave my campus, right? And then the third thing is mobilizing student forces for political action, right? So on campus, and then what do they do when they take that off campus? I heard the sister here talked about the misleadership of black communities. We have to develop black leaders.
Yes.
We have to find youth that have the passion, the ability, and make sure that when it's time for them to go out in the world, they can be the leaders. A lot of there's a book, it's called The Head Negro in Charge Syndrome. And it talks about the development of leadership in black communities from white power structures. Right. We need to take our youth and build leadership within our youth. Because the Black Panthers was a youth organization, right? So if we're, and we look down on our youth, I listen to all the music my students listen to.
Yes.
I don't like it, some of it. But if that's what speaks to them, I need to listen to it, right? And then I put them on to something of you. Have you ever heard of Black Pop, right? Have you ever heard, right? And then we exchange, right? You know who Jay Electronica is? Oh, but I know Chance the Rapper. But that allows a generational gap to be filled, right? Because things like hip-hop, things like culture, they've existed, right? They have remnants in previous generations that we can all connect to. And like I said, community college, for me, specifically at Merritt College, it's a place where I have access to so many students, right? And I don't know what they're doing when they leave campus, but I want to put a word in their heads. So when they leave, they can go on and say, oh, I remember Dr. Clay said such and such a thing. And then they come back to me and they say, oh, that thing we were talking about, I saw it. That's one of the most brilliant things that happens. When you're talking about concepts, and they come back to you and say, you know that thing? I know what you're talking about. Because now they're able to see and make changes, right? So in that legacy, occupying academic space, it doesn't mean physical space, right? But it means the timbre of the space, right? The mood of the space, changing how we interact with our students, changing how we interact with our colleagues, right? To make sure that there's interdisciplinary studies. Just because I'm in sociology doesn't mean that I don't work with Afrin or communication or history, right? I don't have this arrogance about my discipline being something better than anyone else's, right? So as community educators in this legacy of the Panthers, we have to make sure that we're role modeling for our students. Not just how to be students, but how to be citizens, right? Questions about this? Yes, sir.
Mostly at the Oakland Community School. Right now I'm a professor of Africana Studies at San Francisco State. And, on this whole subject of intellectual, development, I wanted to ask the question, how do you develop intellectual agency? By that I mean, one of the things that as a young man attracted me to the party was its thinkers.
Yep.
George Jackson, Huey Newton, that, you had Mao, which was introduced to us.
Thing
that was powerful about the party is it took it outside the classroom. Mm-hmm. So a lot of brothers were almost illiterate coming into the party, but through our study classes, they became very literate. Mm-hmm. They could read Mao and Marx and stuff like that. And so it developed an agency where we felt self-determined intellectually to think for ourselves. We were not slavishly following Marx or Mao or anybody else, which is how we got a George Jackson in Huey Newton. I'm wondering, from your perspective, how do you develop that intellectual agency that we'll need to take the movement to the next level?
Exactly.
We have to learn to think for ourselves from our own perspective, from our own conditions. How do you develop that?
What I try to do in my classrooms is make things very real, mm-hmm. right? So I try to give them an understanding of how this is important to you right now in your daily life. Mm-hmm. Once they start understanding how it's important to them, if they want to make changes, they realize they have that agency, right? Just this week we were talking about ideas of conspicuous consumption and conspicuous labor. The idea that because people get treated differently in society based on our perception of their wealth, right? We do things that make it look like we're wealthy. They all understand, right? For students, right? Oh yes, that's why I have to get the new Jordans.
No.
I want people to know that I got style. So once they can understand, and then you say, but what's the impact of that? And then you connect it to say, well, whether you want to connect it to slave labor, whether you want to connect it to ideas of building wealth or being consumers, once they start realizing there's something I'm doing and it's having this effect, a lot of times they lean in, right? And I hate using that term, but they literally lean in to say, tell me more. Because they're starting to realize, well, if I can change my spending habits or my eating habits or the way I relate to my partner and it can have an impact, they realize that. And once they do, you kind of got it. Because now they're interested because they see small changes, right? For me, it's making sure that they can see a small change. So the stuff that I'm telling them is not abstract, right? I call what I do applied sociology. Because everything has to be applicable to the way they're living their life. I use examples specifically from Oakland in everything I'm talking about because this is where my students live. They'll say, oh, Downs, and they say, oh, because I can see that. And I say, well, this is how this affects you. And they say, because they feel the effects, but they don't always understand that there's anything they can do about it. Once you let them know there's something you can do, they ask, what is it, right? They ask, and then the beauty is, they empower each other, right? One does something and they tell others and then it becomes a group movement. Doesn't always work, but that's how I try to do it. I try to make it very real, as soon as possible. Well, this is what I'm talking about. This is how it relates to you today, when you came up the hill, when you came to camp. Very real. Because then I tell them, how does that impact you? Do you want to try to do something about it? Hand?
Yeah. Francois Alexander from with the Dream Defenders from Miami, Florida. I am so
welcome.
Honored to be
welcome.
Here. Thank you so much. I'm over here looking at you like a superhero. So the only thing that came to mind in terms of intellectual agency and from a concrete standpoint for me would be like X-Men or Thug Mansion, like in terms of a facility where we can, you know, harness those ideas, right? I think one of the reasons why you see the Black Panthers in terms of the strength they had is they eat every day, they study every day with each other. So I think that we now need to be able to put our money where our mouth is and really just start coming up with these dollars and creating these facilities, these spaces that, you know, I think that's
the true. And the thing is, as I was saying earlier, just because you don't see them doesn't mean they don't exist.
That's right.
Right? Because in a city where things get co-opted, things get infiltrated, right? A lot of things that are being done, they're not going to be publicized. Because if you create a space like that, you got to protect the shit out of it, right? So I can't tweet that, right? I can't Snapchat that, right? Because then I open it up to people and I don't know who has access. So I say that because they're happening, right? But they're not going to happen on the surface. Right. I don't have a lot of Twitter followers, but I have a hashtag that says close ranks and fortify. But closing ranks means to stop engaging, right? But if you close ranks, you know, I tell people if something happens to me, close ranks, right? Don't go because now you're giving your energy to them. But you got to protect that. I can't put that out in the public. Those places exist, but I can't put it on the news. I can't.
Blood me, right.
Yeah. He said plug me.
I think the other piece is in terms of people of African ancestry, I think you have to be able to study a time period where folks haven't been colonized, enslaved, basically, you know, impeded on by other folk, right? So you gotta go back almost 6,000 years and we only study that time period for what? The healthiest point for African people, right? And so when I work with young people, because I'm a practitioner first, then educator, right? When I work with young people, it's like cultural knowledge first builds agency, right? So when I'm in the community doing this work with young people, I'm teaching them how to love themselves, using text to like justify their beauty, build race esteem, cultural pride, healthy self-perception. That creates intellectual agency. It's like, brother, what book should I read? How do I get here? How do I do this? It's because now they feel good about themselves as African people.
That freedom school.
Can you spell
hashtag DATT?
Oh, DATT.
Freedom school. Decolonize all the things.
DATT, freedom school. Thank you.
Put it up in the group, yeah.
Thanks.
Yeah. Oh, as soon as this is over, I'm gonna put it up on the thing. I got you. Yes. I saw. Did you have a hand? Yes, ma'am.
Thank you. Oh, how do those who are like a product of gentrification, like myself, get connected to those types of programs that you're talking about, where we're outside of the city, we're from, like, open plan?
I can't
we
see you.
Okay.
We can connect you, but I guess the beauty, the kind of silver lining is we need to build them where we're moving also, right? So talk to me after, right? And I say that because the sister here brought up a point about, you know, going to the South. As we're being forced to migrate, We're in this time right now where we're trying to figure out, do we want to try to make a stand where we are, or do we want to take what we have and try to build something new somewhere else, right? And because we're getting pushed out, we have to have a new start with a better foundation, right? I have some like Southeast Asian students, and one of them's friend got pushed out to Stockton, and she was like, there's no stores where I can get my food, right? But that's the opportunity to create one. Because that's where more people from her community are going to end up being. And if they don't create one, someone's going to create one for them, right? And I say that, so as we get, we have to, a- as we move, we have to take what we have and try to build where we're going, right? We can't, because we lament about what we lost, right? But we still have to build when we get to the next place. I'm not saying don't come back and mobilize here, but we also need to lend support as communities start developing in other places.
How are you doing? Just to reintroduce myself, my name is Paul Holson. I am a current junior journalism major from Howard University. I also serve as its editor-in-chief of student newspaper, The Hilltop. Something that the brother over here in the back from Greenland Friend has talked about, he talked about creating that safe space for those that are not in academics or whatnot. One, to just counter that, because I have to say this out of respect for my school, that I consider our institution a safe space. But with that said, pertaining to schools such as Merritt College or PWI, maybe a question I want to ask to you that I can bring back to my colleagues. How can we, because it's happened before, but now with the times have changed, so now we have to really revitalize that relationship with PWIs or liberal arts schools or things that are not HBCUs. How can we, at students at HBCUs, can assist in bringing those safe spaces to schools such as Merritt or assisting in that dialogue? Because we talk about that, I know at least in my area, we talk about the disconnect between HBCUs and non-HBCUs, but in the same aspect that BSUs are the same brothers and sisters that are in our population. So how can we, in a sense, HBCU students can assist in bring that dialogue?
I think, you know, and it's starting to happen. I know Berkeley's Black Alliance does a lot of leadership trainings for BSUs. Start coming, right? When we talk about Stokely Carmichael, Kwame Ture, and the legacy of SNCC, the ability to mobilize...
Howard alone.
No one knew. The ability to mobilize people from different places in centralized locations, right? That's big. So the reality, I mean, and this is where you use the money that you're, that the schools give you, right, to try to take a delegation of students to a large conference. As we're talking about, again, when I say occupying academic space, I don't necessarily mean on campus. Again, I mean the idea of academia, right? The idea that students and student movements push things forward. Like I said, as a faculty member with the sociology program, with our AFRIM program on campus, that was students and faculty and staff who got those things pushed to exist by threatening to burn down schools. And this is why studying is important. If you look at campuses built after certain times and you see all the concrete, right? That's because during the 60s, all those nice buildings with bricks, you don't see those on more modern campuses because when they built them, we have to make them riot proof. We have to make them demonstration proof. But I say that to say student conferences, they happen. If you have a BSU, mobilize all the BSUs in the DMV area, right? You have so many schools in that area, right? You have Howard, you have, you know, other HBCUs, Norfolk State, you have Georgetown, American University, all those schools, mobilize the students in that area, right? Because that region is a strong, every region is a strong region. So for students, you wanna mobilize each other, right? Because a lot of it is driven by students. I say that because it's not like the Panthers had a 40-year-old person like telling them what to do. A lot of it was self-driven by students who studied, banded together, and were like, we're gonna make our mistakes, but we're gonna do this thing. So as students, organize, learn how to organize. Trial and error, don't be afraid to fail, right? Don't be afraid, because I failed lots. Right? I fail often, right? But it's when you have those, it's like learning how to walk, right? You fall. But once you do walk, that doesn't mean you don't fall again. But as students, I really believe that globally, and I say globally because I haven't even gotten to talk about movements, the influence of the Panthers outside of the United States and the student movements and actions that happened there. But honestly, specifically to you, if you have a BSU, connect with the BSUs at other places in your area, right? Because that's close proximity. As it grows, align with the strong BSUs. I know, like, Cal Berkeley's does some really amazing things. Align with the people there, right? Learn what they're doing, how you can apply it. Because, I mean, the movement is a youth movement. Yes, sir.
Can you please speak more on disengagement? That sounds like so awfully radical, but I see it opening up right, for a lot of this kind of like black male supremacist hotep shit. You see what I'm saying? I remember right after you said that, brother started talking about, you know, you like pride and being pro-black and stuff like that, and I feel you 100%, but at the same time, it leaves the door open for that type of stuff, you know what I mean?
Not the way he's talking about doing it, though. The way he's talking about that, and that's what I said. Like, the way you hear it is the way it's been brought to you before, exactly. Right? So the way he's bringing it, that, what you're talking about, there's no room for that, right? But the reality is, everybody ain't gonna get it. Right, and that's the unfortunate thing that we have to ultimately recognize. Everybody ain't gonna get it, right? So we have to do what we can, right? But the idea of African-centered, but it's, again, you have to study. So there's not this romanticized view of African that doesn't critique the realities that those civilizations weren't perfect either. But, like you were saying, there's a difference between, so there's an idea of African-centered, right? And there's an idea of reactionary resistance to white domination, mm-hmm. right? In America, we talk a lot about how to resist the imposition of whiteness on us. When you study African civilizations, that's before the framing of whiteness to change who we see each other as. Now, that doesn't mean that I'm going to, like I say, automatically think that I'm like straight descendant from Nefertiti, right? And start disrespecting other people or think I'm superior because of that. But acknowledging that there were times when myself as a black woman wasn't defined by white femininity is powerful to acknowledge, right? Because as long as I'm trying to live up to those standards or even resist those standards, that's a lot of energy. And I know black women, and like, that's a lot of energy. Right, so when you talk about disengaging, it's a reframe, it's going around to the source, right? Because if you try to go through whiteness to get to an authentic blackness, you get stuck, right? So you have to go around, right? And it's there. And then what you do is you go back to go forward, right? So oftentimes we talk about ancient civilizations, but I also do a lot of studying about the decolonization of African countries in the 60s, right? And then connecting that to the United States movement. So we have the ancient African, but we also have recent, right? I talked to students, I said, you know Lumumba, you know Thomas Sankara, because a superficial African identity, right, doesn't acknowledge that they're countries, right, and tribes and languages, right? It's not like one whole monolith, right? Does that make sense?
Yes,
sir.
I was gonna say, like, the epicenter of this whole conversation seems to be around, like, when you say occupying space, Charity. So there's this idea of like formal space, and we're constantly trying to broach ourselves as people of color into formal spaces and create these unsanctioned informal spaces like the Panthers created. And I think that that's one of the contradictions as an activist who happens to work at a PWI part of the time that I face is that, you know, as my mom being, as you know, in the Algerian chapter of the Panthers, and being a first-gen refugee of war, you know, understanding that there's an existential contradiction in trying to subvert spaces that weren't designed for you.
Right.
Trying to subvert spaces that you perpetuate simply by proxy of working in them.
Right.
And so I feel like one of the things that we can do, either with Dream Defenders, as academics, activists, scholar activists, whatever you want to call it, revolutionaries, whatever you want to call yourself.
Revolutionaries.
Whatever game you want to play with the words, at the end of the day, it's important for us to remember that existentially, we also live as contradictions if we don't call them out. And so that counter narrative has to exist. And what makes us unmanageable as people is to get our education from places outside of the formal spaces.
Right.
And so I think part of the work is deciding what space means and not to have a hierarchy in terms of space.
Exactly. And that's why I say I don't mean physical space. I mean tone, right? Because this is an academic space right now, right? Right? If I'm talking to students that I meet at the grocery store, right? Or I perform hip hop, that's what I do. And the beauty is I can use it to mobilize people in a space. If you listen to my lyrics, you're gonna hear something that's gonna pique your interest. So yes, when we talk about space, when we say occupying academic space, I just mean the legacy of the Panthers was transforming physical academic spaces and spaces of empowerment.
And academic in conjunction with education, it could be more than just schools. You get your education outside of.
Exactly. That's what I was telling the teacher in the back, right? When he was talking about how to put in your curriculum. And I was like, I don't think the public school is the place for that. Mm-hmm. But the idea, when you occupy, you take it over. Meaning everyone in that space has that ideology. Your teachers. If it's a formal space, your admin, right? And this is when I talk about training leadership. When I talk to my students, I say, what do you want to do? Right? Not what job do you want to have, but what do you want to do? Because there's a lot of ways to get to what you want to do, right? And I say that because we need, people ask, because I have a teaching credential in AFRIN, they say, why do you need AFRIN? I say, because then no one's in sociology, right? If people like me aren't in, so, and this is why I said about like, occupying space. The contradiction always exists, but the reality is, sociology, one, is not a, it's a requirement. So you gotta come through me if you come to Merritt, right? So whether you like it or not, I've put myself in a position where you're gonna get this knowledge, right?
You're gonna get this work.
Yeah, you have to, right? And the thing is, it's a contradiction, right? But the beauty is, for me specifically at Merritt, is that I'm in a position because of the tradition and legacy of the school where, because I'm pretty decent at what I do, I get the freedom to do it in a way that empowers my students. I don't think I could do this if I was at some other schools. So that's the choice I make, right? I said, oh, why don't you go teach here? Because I want to teach here, right? I want to teach these students in these classes on this campus, right? Because it allows me the ability to create space. And it shifts outside the classroom. Like I say, I live in them. I see my students all the time, right? And then I try not to talk to them about school stuff, but when I do sociology that's applied, everything starts to relate, right? So then every space becomes a space. And I say, again, I use the term academic because in this legacy there was a specific influence of the Panthers that changed the culture for black students on college campuses. But the legacy exists beyond just those, right? Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Yes.
How would you say that you can create spaces that kind of transcend geography? Because I'm from Yale University and we have annual Black Solidarity Conference, and so we have like over 70 schools represented, and we come to invite different black students to have like workshops and things like that, but it's like once a year. And so we see there are 70 different schools and over 700 students all in the same place, but it's like for 3 days out of 365.
Yo!
So how would you sustain
this? This is where the tradition of black journalism has to become stronger. Because we say we have a problem doing it, but the Negro, like Garvey was able to do it. Right? Garvey
without
was
Twitter.
Able to. That's what I'm saying. Right? So Garvey, like the Nation Islam, all of these, organizations and movements were able to mobilize through journalism, right? School newspapers. Like you say, social media is like that, decolonized all the things, like when it's a meta resource and everyone has access to it. But it's because the technology that can revolutionize the way we do things, right? We have group chats. I'm sure someone's periscoping this right now, right? So we have the ability, but again, this is where studying comes in. You have to read how the Black Panther newspaper was so successful, mm-hmm. right? Yeah. Read how it was able to be so successful and use what they, and apply it. Because the thing about the legacy of the Panthers is a lot of the questions they answered, right? Now that doesn't mean that they had perfect answers, but in terms of how to mobilize, they were able to do it with a newspaper that had global, right, reach. Mm-hmm. So for students at Yale to be able to reach it, Does Berkeley come to your conference?
The school's varied. Sometimes we have like, I know some last year we had some California
representatives. Yeah. Invite them early. And as it becomes a thing, more people will join, right? And maybe move it. Maybe you have one every year, but it moves, right? And then you deal with different issues regionally. Because it's amazing when someone in Florida, right, can connect something to something local, or something in Connecticut, or something in D.C. that you didn't even know was that similar, right? But the history of, I mean, the legacy of black journalism, it needs to improve, right? We've given in to mainstream media propaganda, and we don't tell our own stories anymore, yeah. Right? We get fed a narrative, and we believe it, and then we perpetuate it, right? We're not even being critical. We have few, right? But we need to control the narrative instead of always reacting and responding to what people are telling you. We're very reactive. That's what think pieces are, right? You're like, ooh, I got a thought about this, right? But you want to put your narrative out there first. So now everyone is using your framework to think. That's what I said about black on black violence, right? The idea that if we frame it in an understanding that it's a recent phenomenon, only within the last 30 years have black people been fundamentally killing and brutalizing each other after 400 years of white, you know, we didn't start this, right? But if you provide that context, then anyone who comes with a conversation after that, they gotta fall in line. Or you don't engage them, right? Also, with being community support, right? That's the third thing I'm getting into. If you have a school on, you need to be in that community. You need to be in those high schools, in those middle schools, in those after school programs, because we have a problem with generational letdown, right? You'll have, I've been reading a lot about the student movements of the 60s. That was an amazing generation of students, right? But then when I look at the people, you know, 10 years older than me, they didn't have that, right? And some of it is because of the repression or the consequences that they saw people facing for standing up. But some of it is because the narrative in our country started funneling people to different types of education, right? Go on Wall Street. Become a broker, right? So it started changing what we valued as important in terms of education. So keeping the schools, keeping keeping the students on these campuses, because the reality is black students are going to college. So if they're going to college, we have to reach them where they are. Like you said, there's a contradiction about me being who I am and teaching at my school is not predominantly white, actually. It's not officially an HBCU, but white students are the minority population. But the contradiction, the way I resolve the contradiction is because that's where they are. And if I don't get them where they're there, then when they go somewhere else, they're not getting the knowledge that they need, right? So would I prefer if it was an organic, but they're at Merritt. And they're gonna, so where they are, I have to be there because that's where they are, right? So that's kind of how I resolve that conflict. You know, if you're in the space, you're perpetuating the oppression.
Right, like Touareg representation versus black power.
Always. Right. Yes, sir.
Okay, this is going to be fragmented because I've been also trying to keep up with you and not tune you out to get a master of question. So what I've been thinking about over here is I used to go to Tuskegee, right? I didn't graduate. I ended up graduating from PWR. But I'm still in contact with my network from Tuskegee. So just this week, I was having a conversation with a young woman as everyone's ramping up to go to homecoming and all this, and I was asking, are you going to be having any conferences, talking about the issues that are affecting our people? Like, what are you doing to, what's happening at Tuskegee to be a part of the fight? And her response, because she's very active, and her response was, we are so caught up in money that we really don't have time for all of that. And so, I've been over here just going through it all about money and economics and this and that. And a lot of what I was hearing is that either you're in the circle and invited to the knowledge, or you're going to have to get it in college. But without the finance, how do you get that? And then I'm over here thinking about the numbers, in the education department, talking about how, black families are more like, the debt that we take to try to get the knowledge. And we end up fighting it our entire lives. I don't know. I think that there has to be a space in the middle. I understand that you do need to protect, the strategy behind it all. But there needs to be a space for people who can't afford or decide that they don't want to go their whole lives in debt for an education. That's, keep in mind, places like HBCUs, they're still getting their money from Kraft and Boeing. That's the other reason. It's not just about the money. It's about where their money is coming from. Mm-hmm. That's allowing them not to be be such advocates in the fight. So I understand that's completely fragmented, but I'm hoping
to be a part of the conversation. No, the reality is it's not. So again, when I'm talking about using the knowledge specifically to empower community, the fact that if you are on a college campus, like I said, go into the community, go into the elementary schools, not just in the elementary schools for the students, but start trying to mobilize parents, right? What I'm saying is taking what you get as a group of students to do things in that community. If you have a school in an area and there's a distressed black community there and you're at BSU, all you do is stuff on campus, right? That's you're doing it wrong. right? Because since you're the ones getting, ideally, if you have the space where you're getting the training, it becomes your responsibility to make sure that you're giving it to people who don't have access to it. Fundamentally, that's the part. The part is taking what you learn at places that you have access to and sharing that with people who don't have the access. That's the fundamental part of it, right? Because otherwise, we get this talented temp type of thing where, like you said, either you're invited to participate, or you have to pay in, or you just don't get it. But I specifically talk about mobilizing students because they got all the energy, right? They got all the passion. So if they're able to be in the communities, then it develops, and then you have pipelines. So if you have, because like I said, students are going to college. Part of the education is knowing how not to get into debt, right? I tell my students all the time at community college, take advantage, right? Take advantage of the fact that it's $54 per credit, right? Wow. Instead of going to a UC, because someone's told you that community college education is inferior, mm-hmm. right? Realizing that you're saving thousands of dollars, mm-hmm. right? And like I tell my students, my class sizes are relatively small, right? So you have time to engage in a way that you may not. But again, it's restructuring their understanding of what education means, what they're supposed to do with it. Because again, I grew up in a generation that was told, get out of the hood, right? I grew up in the 90s where everybody was trying to get out, right? So helping our students know that you have to be a part. But that's the idea of using the knowledge to specifically empower communities. And I talk about the programs because these are things that we still need in our communities. When we talk about the legacy of these programs, there's no reason why, I know at Merritt we've been trying to get a food bank because the Laney Tower did an expose about homelessness, right? And the reality that if you've been, those of you who aren't living here, if you drive around long enough, you'll see tent cities under almost every underpass, right? So the reality is that food security is still needed, right? So all of these programs are still needed. Health clinics, right? Help the, there's one Kaiser in Oakland, right? Kaiser is kind of the default HMO for people who can't afford PPO insurance. Anecdote about myself, I was driving and a guy ran a red light, hit my car a couple years ago, and I had to have hip surgery. I had to wait a year to get hip surgery because of the insurance I had, right? So there's a fundamental need for all these services, but we have to know how to do this. I ask my students who want to go in healthcare, why do you want to go in healthcare? Well, because it's good money. Kind of. Because the money is not as good as someone told you it's going to be. But if I want to make a kind of movement, I need someone who knows first aid. I need someone who knows how to perform CPR. So the education is useful. Everybody's useful, right? But we have to start getting the knowledge and apply it for this program. But not at all am I, because not at all am I trying to say that this should be work that's focused in academia. The thing that I say, though, is that the legacy of the Panthers is that they were able to use it, right? When we're talking about students at PWIs, they have money. You go to your student services and student activities and write up a proposal, they have money for it. Why not use that, right? Why not leverage some of the things you have? Of course, there's a contradiction in using the space and where the money comes from, right? But if you have access to things, it's kind of up to you to provide it to those who don't have. HBCUs, the money issue is always a thing, right? But in that case, maybe you have schools that do have money, go to an HBCU and have something there because it's easier for them to try. This is where the strategy and tactics come in, right? Because if you don't have money but you have the knowledge, I got to find some way to get the people to where you are. PWIs, they got money. And all these diversity initiatives, they would love to write up in a report that they sent a delegation of minority students to go talk about issues. See how cool that shit sounds? Right? Right? If you're a student, write that shit up. Right? And submit it to your dean or your advisor. Right? And use that to go build with someone at a Tuskegee or someone who's struggling for money to do these things. Right? Any other questions? I got about 10 minutes. Yes, sir. Oh, I got you too.
I kind of wanted to get your take. You mentioned black journalism, mm-hmm. and there was an interesting situation that happened with this kind of a kill the messenger, you kill the message strategy with The Birth of the Nation in that film.
Oh.
And my issue and I guess my concern was There was a lot of valuable information that needed to be understood from the Nat Turner legacy.
Mm-hmm.
And there were black journalists that even spoke up about it, but there was this backlash even towards the journalists for bringing up the issues of, say, slavery and understanding that we need to have in the history of black journalism. So I just wanted to get your thoughts on that. I know it's complex.
No, it's a very lot.
But yeah, I wanted to kind of bounce back with some people on the internet, but I felt like that wasn't the space to engage with.
It's probably not. Yeah. I've learned in my attempts to use Twitter to be this amazing. Initially, for me, it was. I joined Twitter when I was a grad student at Texas A&M University. Texas A&M University is the most conservative, right? White supremacy. I could go days on campus without seeing another person that looked like me.
Yeah.
So at that time, Twitter was this place where I could engage with people all over the world who thought like me, who validated my ideas and my experience. It's not like that anymore. It's not like that anymore, right? The way the content is filtered, and this is why I said we have to study systems, because they saw that it was being, that the potential it had, and they created these algorithms that change what you even have access to, what content you have access to, right? And that's why I say they do very good at studying us to continue the oppression. So Twitter is not that space anymore. Anytime you have to, but the Black Panther newspaper, the beauty of it is it was self-contained. Right? So the people who were reading because they wanted that knowledge, and there was really nowhere else to get it. So because there's a vacuum that can be filled with black journalism, but if you're afraid of consequences, the consequences of who? Right? If you're not writing for a publication that tells you what to do, you have the freedom not to worry about it. Now it's hard, but I think it can be done, right? Now about your kill the messenger thing with the Nat Turner thing, I don't think it was a kill the messenger strategy, right? Honestly, if people in here seen the film, I don't want to be like a spoiler. Truth one, there's a lot of people that don't want to see the film, right?
Yeah.
So there was this narrative about boycotting. A lot of people just didn't want to see it.
Yeah.
The truth is, I don't want Hollywood to tell me about Nat Turner. Right?
Exactly.
Now, when I go watch the Hollywood film, I want to match it up to what I've already learned about Nat Turner. There's no way that I should be introduced to the legacy of Nat Turner by Hollywood. I don't care what black person made it, it's still a Hollywood film. So it has to abide by the constraints and the narrative that Hollywood needs to perpetuate certain narratives. So again, while we're engaging in that, what should have happened is there's a film out, okay, now let's take some time to dig into the real, right? So this film doesn't become the definitive narrative of this man's legacy,
which is
because now we're talking about the film and all, but you know what people aren't talking about? Nat Turner, right? Because we've engaged about Nate Parker and the things he's done and, you know, this idea that black feminists have destroyed the idea that black feminists sabotage the success of a movement, like where do these narratives, we have to question these type of narratives that divide us before we respond to them, right? Because I don't know any person who wants black solidarity that would pit people against each other around something like Nat Turner. Like put that shit to the side, right? Like why are you drawing lines now? So we have to question it. Even the people who perpetuate those narratives, and that's where good journalism can thrive, right? Because people are hungry for the truth, and they don't know where to get it. And the beauty about journalism is oftentimes a gateway into more quote-unquote academic work, right? You start off reading a newspaper or a leaflet, and then you transition into something really, one of these thick, super big meta-narrative books. Right? Does that kind of get to it?
Yeah, a little bit. I mean, I saw a lot of people criticizing the film without seeing it, and then the issue I had with that is they wouldn't post about actual Nat Turner in the history. So it was the criticism without the issue.
But the thing is, that's what spins the property, like, that's how the media industry thrives. So the unfortunate thing is, if I'm a writer, and I want to get paid to write something, I gotta write what's gonna get the, especially when you're talking about social media types, I gotta write what's gonna get the clicks.
True.
I might write the most amazing piece about the legacy of Nat Turner and the connections, but I have to write something that people are gonna click on, because that's gonna determine how I get my money. So if I'm writing for money, then that's gonna fundamentally frame what I write. And that's why I talk about the Panther newspaper, because they weren't writing to that audience. So when you, because the critiques come because I need to write something that someone's gonna read, because otherwise they're not gonna pay me. Does that make sense? Because if that's not your concern, right, then you don't fall into that trap. Does that make sense?
Yeah, thank you.
All right. Yes.
Yeah, two quick simple questions. A, when do I find your music, and B, let's jam.
Yes. I'm on the SoundCloud. Charity Clay. I have no pseudonym. Charity Clay is SoundCloud.com/CharityClay. That's where all my stuff is.
Are you guys leaving? You can't leave.
I just followed
you. Yeah. Oh yeah. I have Twitter. I never give out my information.
You can't.
Hey, you're easy to find.
You can't leave.
It's you are. FAV Charity, your fave charity. That's me on Twitter, on Instagram. A couple things, because I know we're running out of time. But I use this quote, right? The revolution has always been in the hands of the young always inherit the revolution. The reason I do this workshop, oh, thank you. You're good at that. I promise you. Is because I say this again, if it wasn't for the Panthers, I wouldn't be Dr. Clay. I wouldn't be because what they allowed to fester in me was something that I love to give to my students, right? But I know that it only goes as far as I teach them to go, right? We have a terrible generation gap where we have an older generation still trying to compete with the youth because they don't feel they're recognized or they still want to get their shine. Like, there's nothing wrong with stepping back and allowing them to thrive, because if our youth thrive, then we thrive also,
yes,
right?
Yes.
Couple more things. I've said this, right? Three things. We have to study what influenced the Panthers, right? We also have to read what they wrote. They wrote so many things. And then we have to be critical of the things that were written and said about them after, right? If anyone emails me, I can give you the slides. So I just have a collection of books, right? We got Negroes with Guns, we got Shades of Guerrilla Warfare, Malcolm X Speaks, Communist Manifesto, Fire Nick, just books that they read. Read these. And I say that because this will contextualize and give you a better understanding of what the Panthers were doing and where they were coming from, right? As you develop that agency, you can develop a critique. Like, oh, I see how the Panthers used Lenin, but in 2016, if we want to employ those same strategies, it's going to look a little different, right? The second thing is, there's so many autobiographies and collections of essays from members of the first-hand narratives about their actual experience. You got to read them, right? This exhibit is dope, but it doesn't replace reading someone telling their life story about the time they spent in this movie. Right? And then again, you have to read and be critical about what's written about. The first book I read that introduced me to the Black Panther Party was Agents of Repression. I read it when I was 13 years old. It's about the FBI secret war against the Black Panther Party and the American Indian Movement. I was 13 when I read it. It blew my mind. At 13, I had no idea that the government was so brutal.
Evil.
Right? But the beauty of it was that it was written in a way that's irrefutable, right? Because if you say these things, people say, oh, it couldn't have been that bad. But when I saw how the evidence was presented, that allowed me to say, this is how you tell a story. This is how you make it real for people who refuse to believe it coming straight from your mouth, right? And that's what kind of got me into academia. But there's a lot of great books. I want to end with... I want to play this though.
Basically, knowing my identity, you can support some of our programs. You know what you're saying? Find out. And you believe in programs like children's programs. You got
the kids? We believe they could pay. As a focal point to organize their mothers and fathers.
Can you
hear
the mic?
Peace.
Oh, yes.
There's no basic children's program here?
asking where our education program is.
You set that up for, I think we can put everything on one piece of paper. What about this bank?
Credit union? Mm-hmm.
Credit union.
Credit union, my brother.
It is a bank.
Are you giving to a credit union?
It is a bank.
Are you going about it?
Yeah, it is a bank. Owned by the people, run for the people, and by the people.
What would money be given out to people for?
Well, the people would decide that. People in the community would decide.
You need some living room furniture, maybe? You need a car, maybe?
See, I got, the thing is with me, Dig, I need to know some more about it. She has some ability about the education thing here. Because, you did, it's full of me concerned, struggle. When you look at struggle, is that this depends on the education thing.
This depends on the education.
Well, the whole thing. No, but you can form this with no education. You can form this.
No, yeah. That's the way we talk about forming. You know, right. We're talking about forming it right. You know, it's not on the paper. We didn't write it on paper.
Forming it right. No.
Okay.
Let me give you an example. Yomo Kenyatta formed the Exodus Revolution with no education. And then at the end of the day, Yomo told the motherfucker, I said, well, he did it, but I'm your brother. I helped you beat the revolution. Now I'm more pressure. Another example, Papa Doc Haiti. Papa Doc Haiti hated everything white. Man, you couldn't make the white paper in front of Papa Doc's face. But he moved on over to be a president there, calling no education. And the people have been educated, they said that we don't hate the motherfucker white people, we hate the president, whether he be white, black, brown, or yellow. So that's the education program to find out what is going to be in the finale. A lot of people, what Yomo Kenyatta is called not a never revolutionary, but an ex-revolutionary. So it's Papa Doc. They brought on a successful revolution. That thing ain't under 9 miles with a bitch. What you're saying is the end. But you don't judge Castro now. You can't do it. Nobody's going to judge whether Castro's going to be a revolutionary or not. You know what I mean? We're talking about things, you know what I mean? China, the People's Republic, and even the state then now, talking about even going on further into a communistic state. That's what we're talking about. That was a revolutionary. So we got to understand here the educational program that you have to be able to figure out whether it will go on the right lines, whether people will end up in a situation where they can be able to really control themselves. You understand what I'm saying? With no education, the people take this local foundation and start stealing money because they won't be really educated to watch the people thing anyway. You understand what I'm saying? With no education, you have neo-colonialism instead of colonialism like you got in Africa now, like you got in Haiti. So what we're talking about is there has to be education program, that's very important. As a matter of fact, it's so important that a person has to go through 6 weeks of optimism and education before he considers himself a member of the party, able to even run down ideology for the party. Why? Because if they don't have the education, then they're nowhere. They don't stand nowhere, because they don't know why they're doing what they're doing. You might get people caught up in an emotionless movement. You understand? You might get people caught up because they're poor and they want something. And they'll be not educated, they want more, and before you know it, they'll be Catholic. Before you know it, we have a Negro in here.
Thank you all for coming. I'm sincerely humble. I'm always like, nobody's gonna come. I really believe that you all made this space a beautiful thing. I couldn't have done this without y'all, so I appreciate y'all being here. If you want to exchange info or anything, I'll be up here for a while. Holler at me. Connect with each other, right? If anyone has any announcements,
but I have to clear this room.
I'll be out there.
I got to have you out of here, like, right now.